I'm in front of my old grade school, St. Lambert Elementary, a building with much local historical significance, hence the World War I memorial I'm looking at. But that's a told story and besides the point. I'm here today to talk about something that's been, until this very moment, unwritten in this school's history. No statue commemorating it. See, after dark one fateful night, probably in 2005, in the mostly barren basement of this school, my friends and I found a big red box. A big red box whose contents we heroically misunderstood, predicating subsequent cascades of wrong assumptions, which ultimately resulted in the co-creation of the greatest game you've never played. The greatest game you really can't ever play. Not again. A game that until this very moment, less than maybe a dozen people have ever known existed.
Now, what was in this box didn't matter so much as what, as I'd find out years later at a rather revelationary Christmas party, was supposed to be in the box. Inside the crimson shell was just a mess of scattered paper cards, but critically omitted were an instruction booklet for understanding the game, a board to track progress, a small hourglass to time rounds, and most importantly, the large red plastic eponymous Hedbanz. As much as I'd like to keep it a mystery and keep the suspense going, I can't reasonably tell any more of this story without revealing to you now that what we found in the school basement was an incomplete game of Hedbanz, the semi-popular social party game. I've gathered that it was likely the 1991 edition, but specifically the Canadian version, though I'll be honest, I haven't been able to find a copy with all the cards I remember as a kid, so take that with a grain of salt. Now, the gang of us took one good look at what was in this box, tidied up the cards into a thick deck, thumbed through some of them, talked it over, and made two decisions about what we inferred was clearly supposed to be a game of some kind. And I say decisions rather than assumptions because at the time there was not a doubt in any of our minds that we were right. Like I said, misunderstandings were had. Years later, I chalk it up to kid brain, of course, but while I admit our second decision was absolutely insane and hilarious and born of a lack of attention span, the first made sense. Given the limited scope of experience any of us had had as kids, it followed reason, as in, we had reason to believe we were right. And so the decision we made, as wrong as it was kinda fucking ingenious, and I kinda wish I could take full credit for it. First, we decided on the rules. Now, among our group, we had fair knowledge of a couple of card games. We knew at least there were like two kinds of card games out there. Ones with numbers and suits that were meant for counting or betting, and then there were trading cards. Ones with little drawings of characters, stat blocks, power levels, cards you used to simulate combat in strategy matches. Since the cards in this box had characters on them, many drawn in perilous and provocative situations, we inherently knew that this game was of the latter type, a character card battling game. Second, we decided its name. Now, your obvious question, what do you mean you decided its name? The name was written on the box. Sure, the manual was missing, so it made sense for you to invent your own rules, but come on, the name was right there. You telling me you didn't read it? Oh, okay, I hear you. To answer your question, we did read it. Probably only once, not very well. But I think we thought we had read it right, and then just kind of became blind to the text on the box, because no doubt, had we looked at the cover for 1 second longer, which would have been at least twice as long as we had, and processed the actual title and observed the box art featuring these three cuddlers wearing the eponymous yet absent peripheral, I'm sure we would have understood what Hedbanz was called and how it was meant to be played, and that obviously the contents of this basement-dwelling box were incomplete. Instead, we made an exhaustive list of inferences based on half-paid attention, and because we were kids, just assumed we were right. Our judgment, in our opinion, was infallible.
I can't explain why, but on that night, one of us must have just half-read the title on the box, and then for years, we never second-guessed that this game that we straight-up just assumed we knew how to play was legitimately called what we had accidentally named it. This was Habendaz.
A completely normal thing for my friends and I to say to each other when class ended was, "Hey, want to go downstairs and play Habendaz? Hey, you staying tonight? We could play Habendaz. Oh, it's raining. They're going to make us stay in for recess. Want to go get Habendaz?" Yeah, what can I say? We're stupid as hell.
Okay, so how the fuck do you play a game invented by a bunch of fourth graders who didn't actually think they invented it? Well, it might make sense to walk through some of those aforementioned inferences so you can see how we settled on what just must have been the rules.
So first, you've got to understand that Yu-Gi-Oh! Was popular at the time, and it became the rule set's skeleton. From what I remember about Yu-Gi-Oh! And Habendaz, that meant each player had two rows of cards. The set closest to you were your fighters, which had to be placed face up in attack mode or sideways in defense mode. The set above you were your trap, effect, or environment cards. If I remember correctly, the little desk we had found to play didn't have a lot of space, so we also decided that there would be a maximum of four columns. In practice, playing Habendaz in recent years, I think we were right on track with that one, otherwise it becomes far too chaotic. Why we settled on a Yu-Gi-Oh!-like two-row setup was down to an observation we'd made. See, not all of Habendaz's cards featured characters. Some depicted places or objects. We gathered this meant that cards didn't necessarily need to be fighters, such as, let's say, in Pokemon. Some could be traps or effects. We also concluded that there was an element of choice as to what exactly you wanted your card to do, unlike Yu-Gi-Oh! Cards, which color-coded the different types and dictated their own use as far as I remember. Habendaz gave no indication as to how a card must be played. There were no descriptions or power levels or any of that shit, so we figured it was just up for us to pick for ourselves. Let me give you an example. If I were playing a location card, such as Miami or Desert Island, if I intended to, I could either use that play to change the battlefield to that location, or I could summon the little character on the card as a fighter. Similarly, with a more abstract concept like carpool, I could either summon the car and the passengers depicted in the drawing, or place it as a trap card defending my football-playing Miami Dolphin, meaning when my opponent calls on Shirley Temple to attack, she gets stuck in the carpool lane. Like Yu-Gi-Oh!, before the start of every turn, you'd need to draw from the deck to keep your hand at 6 cards. You could place as many or as few as you wanted per turn, but you couldn't exceed the physical limit of the table we were playing on, nor draw more cards if you already had 6 in your hand. Except there was a key difference between Habendaz and Yu-Gi-Oh!, which later proved crucial to the playability of matches given how we decided scoring should work. More on that in a bit. Instead of each player having their own distinct deck, the deck was communal, as in, go fish style, or admittedly, just like Hedbanz itself. The entire game's cards were placed off to the side and drawn from together. I mean, it didn't make sense to handle cards any other way. So, the deck is stacked, the players have their hands, we know where to put our cards and how to use them. One question left, and it's a big one. How in the ever-living fuck are plays actually resolved? Like, you and I play cards against each other. A beach ball versus Hugh Hefner. Great. How the hell do we determine who wins? There's no numbers on these cards, no big paragraphs explaining how they work. Cards are on the table, though, facing each other. Where do we go from here? You know what? Let's walk through a real-ass big-ass play to see how it works. Say I've got Joan of Arc in defense mode in the North Pole, and you pull out Muhammad Ali and John Wayne for a tag team. You're thinking, looks easy enough, 2-on-1, end of story. But as you're coming in, oh, you've sprung my traps, pickle jar and dental floss. Now, what I say happens here is that Muhammad Ali gets trapped in the pickle jar, just like the guy in the drawing, and because we're in the North Pole, the brine freezes and he's dead. John Wayne, on the other hand, gets a floss trap sprung on him, gets tangled up like this kid and incapacitated. Easy takedown for Joan, I say. You, however, have the chance to disagree. Instead, you suggest this outcome. John Wayne? As a cowboy, he's immune to all rope-based traps. He turns the floss against Joan, using it as a lasso to tie her up. You concede that Ali does fall for the pickle jar, but argue that John Wayne uses Joan's campfire to thaw the pickle juice and resuscitate him. Basically, any interpretation of the cards, including any minor background elements in their drawings, was fair game. And of course, both players were entitled to their opinions. Cool, so we both made our cases. How the hell do we pick who's right? Well, that's where the audience comes in. Habendaz was a group effort, both in its conception and its play. In light of the absence of any objective way to resolve matches, Habendaz assumed the form of a weird celebrity fantasy debate match. Two players would place cards on opposite ends of the table, would describe what they think would happen in such a scenario, and then the audience would deliberate until a verdict was reached. The resolution didn't always need to make sense, sometimes choices were made based on creativity or other factors, but what matters was that the round was settled, killed cards were removed from the field, and the next round could begin. So, to get back to the play at hand, I'm not actually entitled to say how Joan of Arc versus John Wayne and Muhammad Ali in a pickle jar in the North Pole resolves. That's what you're here for. For real, pause this video for a sec, mull it over if you don't already have an opinion, and before leaving a comment telling me what you think the outcome should be, check what other people have said, just in case they give credence to one side or another. But do, please, tell me which way you see that matchup going.
Back in grade 4, we did come up with a concession for two-player matches, because by the nature of where and when we played, our audiences were guaranteed to whittle down over time. What I've neglected to mention yet was that the room that housed the big red Habendaz box wasn't accessible during normal school hours. The only time you could get in was when they unlocked it in the final period of after-school daycare.
I don't know how other places do this, so forgive me my explanation if you're familiar with the concept, but after-school daycare was a service offered by St. Lambert Elementary for kids whose parent or guardian situation led them not to be able to take the school bus home at 4. On paper, this was meant to support situations where kids' parents both worked full-time and wouldn't be at home to receive them at drop-off. In practice, though, and as a consequence of my school's particular demographic, most daycare kids were there because their parents were divorced, whereas bus kids had married guardians.
It's a little hard to explain, and I don't want to go all the way down this rabbit hole, at least not today, but it did impact how we played Habendaz, and leaving it out of the story would be a mistake, so just hear me out for a sec. The demographic of my school lagged behind the rest of society in most matters. Despite divorce rates slowly dropping at the time, my school was not a sample reflective of the general population. Instead, trends here tended to be delayed by a generation. That is to say, unlike most French-Canadian families who at the time would have likely had two working parents and would have needed a daycare service whether or not they were divorced, families of children at my school tended to be structured differently. Let me make it clear that this isn't conjecture. To be legally allowed enrollment in an English school board here meant you needed to be grandfathered in by a clause that disproportionately applied to specific ethnic minorities, my own included, who compared to the much more progressive and feminist Quebec at the time, still adhered to traditional values carried over from the old countries. Meaning, the prevailing pattern among ethnic kids where I went to school was they had a working dad and a stay-at-home mom. Lagging one generation behind in most trends, Gen X, aka our parents, were the first in our ethnic groups to really hop on that divorce train. Another way to look at it is I didn't know a single kid with divorced grandparents, but a lot of folks whose parents split. Similarly, most of my old schoolmates, especially if they were girls, were the first in their families to pursue higher education, whereas women in the general Quebecois populace had been established in academia and the workforce for a whole generation already. And I don't think I need to explain, but divorce is much different when both parents are independent, work, and have the capacity to provide for themselves versus in a quote-unquote traditional setup where one depends on the other. So, all this to say, Habendaz was a game designed and played exclusively by kids of broken families being raised by struggling single mothers. And in retrospect, that bias impacted how some parts of it worked.
As I said, the room where we found and played Habendaz was only accessible in the last period of daycare. Basically, once school ended and daycare began, we had about an hour of homework followed by an hour of play, and by that point it was 6 o'clock, so most of the monitors themselves were ending their shifts. And with reduced staff, they'd shuffle us into an old storage room where they could keep a better eye on those of us remaining, inferable from the late hour, those with more complex home life situations. So, the sidelines of every single game of Habendaz ever played consisted of a bunch of kids who all certainly would have rather been at home at 7 p.m. on a weekday, but who were stuck in the dingy school basement waiting for their newly single and back-to-school moms to finish their own evening classes and come pick them up. Or maybe Dad's picking them up tonight. Not really sure. Split custody is complicated. Mechanically, this meant that the system that resolved matches was guaranteed to fail at some point. From the moment Habendaz became playable each night, the audience tasked with judging and determining match outcomes would slowly disappear. Every game of Habendaz was guaranteed to end in two players facing off sans arbitration.
Our environment and demographic impacted Habendaz in two major ways. First, Habendaz did not have a scoring system. It didn't have points, you didn't really play to win. By playing Habendaz, you were already winning, because it represented an alternative to simply moping around, staring at the clock, waiting for your mom to come pick you up. The goal was simply to enjoy time spent with your friends. It was never a game meant to inspire competition or scorekeeping, but rather conversation. And holy fuck, did it.
One particular event that occurred at the Habendaz table all those years ago still sticks with me. It was maybe one of the first interesting debates I or my friends had ever been a part of, and even though I don't remember my own stance, I remember the reasoning and conversations it sparked. See, the Habendaz deck had a Mother Nature card, which we had decided was basically God. You could play this in almost any way you wanted and always win. No other card could stand up to the forces of nature, we agreed. Until one day, a friend of mine pointed out that the killer bee represented an affront to divine creation. Did Mother Nature's domain include human works? Isn't the creator's authority over all forces undermined when man plays God? Tough topics for a couple of fourth graders, eh? Which is probably why it attracted the attention of some of our monitors, who each had their own opinions.
If I recall correctly, the ruling resulted in Mother Nature's overthrowing as an invulnerable trump card. Her weakness was now natural processes interrupted by man in some way. This may be a stretch, but I think we were also partly inspired by a French-Canadian camp game called Champ de Bataille, where the gimmick is that the strongest card's only weakness is the game's weakest card. But either way, it led to very interesting conversations and matches. I recently found out that the kid who came up with the killer bee caveat is now a biochemist, so I guess he hasn't let this go either. I have a feeling I'll never see this, but just in case. Yo, Babs, what's good? We should catch up sometime.
Now, do not get it twisted. The lack of a score and emphasis on for fun, not to win, didn't mean you couldn't still be good at it. It's just that being good meant something different than Habendaz. In that way, it was less like Yu-Gi-Oh! Whose end state was coupled to player skill, and was more like Tag, whose playtime only expired at the sound of a bell, or arrival of your mom, as it were. The second way that Habendaz's player circumstances impacted it was that the peaceful resolution was incentivized. So far, I've been framing Habendaz as a combative card game, but really a more apt comparison would be to folk or social games. Things like Truth or Dare, Cards Against Humanity, or even D&D. Now, everyone plays Truth or Dare differently. Some, for instance, go in a circle, which is lame as hell. But the way I always played was that the next target was always selected by the previous, meaning if you just got picked, you get to pick next. If we had to break it down, and we will, the goal of Truth or Dare is to make your friends reveal truths or perform dares of your choice. To accomplish that, you need to get a sufficient number of picks yourself, which means there are two dominant strategies. To have the most fun in Truth or Dare, you need to either express enough weirdness to clearly be willing to perform even the grossest of dares, or live so scandalously that picking you for truth is irresistible. Even so, there's a limit to what you and others can ask of each other. Some dares go too far, and some questions are too personal. It's in nobody's best interest to lead the group to an impasse, a dare that can't possibly be accomplished, or a truth too uncomfortable to reveal. Either so vibe-ruining that the game can't possibly be continued. And so, even though the goal is to make your friends do and say weird things, you're incentivized not to stir the pot too hard. Similarly, in D&D, nobody has fun when the team is held up over a petty argument. With no real win state, you win these sorts of games just by continuing to play, continuing to see your friends once a month and carry on the story. That's why in Habendaz, even when down to the two last players, both are motivated to resolve conflicts amicably. Why? Well, because of a rather ingenious omission of a scoring system. Anyone playing Habendaz as opposed to doing nothing interesting was already winning. Being so stubborn that you caused deadlock was really the only way to lose. So, why not chill the fuck out, you know?
That door back there labeled G is actually connected to the room where we used to play Habendaz. Those two little parking spots there, I don't know if you can see them, but that's where parents kind of like pulled up to pick us up. There was a double set of doors and a staircase for security, so parents needed to like pull up, go in, get buzzed in, confirm their identity, and then they would be allowed to pick you up. So playing here was actually strategic. You could half pay attention to the game and half attention to the little window there, enough of a view to kind of like spot and recognize your mom's headlights and pack up your shit in advance before the monitor told you your mom was there. Another fun fact, Justin Trudeau himself once subbed at this school back when he was like a teacher or whatever. I don't really remember much about that day except all the other teachers wanting to take photos with this random guy and this beaver puppet that he had. It was like this this like thing he put on his hand and he would go like, the beaver does this, the beaver does that. There was probably some lesson associated with it. I don't really remember. Overall, really strange dude. Yeah, weird guy.
As much as I passed it off as a joke before, I'd be lying if I said I didn't legitimately see Habendaz as a part of this school's history, or at the very least, my own. A condition met by Habendaz, which in my opinion qualifies it to be labeled history, is that it's dead. Habendaz was a game as much as it was a thing that happened for a particular time before ceasing, and it cannot be re-experienced. Not by you, not by me, not by anyone. At least, not the way it was originally intended to be played.
I tried at one point counting how many people in the world have ever known this game existed, how many kids I could remember from back in the day who stayed late enough at school to gather around that little table and play it. I almost said 10, but then I remembered that two are sadly no longer with us. And not to trivialize the deaths of real people, my old friends by circumstance from back in the day, but it made me realize just how precious this memory is to me, and honestly motivated me to share this story and record its existence. Habendaz probably was a coping mechanism for some of us. Like I said, a way to pass the time better than any other we could come up with. As many times as I've tried resuscitating the game, its strange rules don't make as much sense when taken out of the after 6 p.m. pre-smartphone era, kinda sad waiting for your single mom to pick you up environment it had been conceived in and adapted to by we, its designers. It wasn't made to be played under any circumstances but those.
It also hasn't aged well, by no fault, I should say, of ours. The 1991 Canadian edition of Hedbanz, which Habendaz is coupled to, was clearly very mature audience-oriented, if you know what I mean. Raunchy or edgy would be suitable modern descriptors. Some of the cards are pretty racist, is what I'm trying to say. Now, I'll be honest, that edginess, back in the day when it went over our heads, did make the characters depicted in these cards better fighters, so to say. The excessive props or jokes targeted at adults became gimmicks or sidearms in our dumb kid brains, incapable of understanding the offense. In the years since, Hedbanz itself has persisted, though mutated into a family-friendly game. As much more marketable as that's likely made the game, it unfortunately means Habendaz can't be played with a modern Hedbanz deck, which ironically is also why if you've played Hedbanz recently, you likely ripped off little pieces of paper and wrote your own prompts. The new deck isn't as raunchy, but it also isn't as funny anymore.
Why the hell am I telling the story of a dead game, though? Look, Habendaz was a fun thing to do, done by a bunch of kids who'd rather not be where and when and how they were. Habendaz was so much fun, though, it almost changed that. It replaced the dread brought on by the school bell, your jealousy towards the kids you'd watch line up for the bus, knowing your school day wouldn't end until sundown. But at least you could look forward to that one particular point in the night when most of the monitors themselves had called it a day, and those left shuffled you into this little old storage room where you could finally get your hands on that mysterious dark red box whose title you'd never learn how to pronounce.
Then and there, you could let your imagination run wild, invent scenarios, and tell stories with your friends, learning about yourself and the world around you through the warped, often offensive, and definitely not suitable for kids, windows of these tiny cards. Habendaz is dead, though. This video may as well be its memorial, and so there's nothing for you to gain from knowing about it, right? You can't play it, and I can't fulfill my duty as a YouTube guy to influence you to. It just doesn't exist anymore. Well, thing is, it's also history. Habendaz was the best game I ever made or played, and nobody will ever be able to play it again. Its time has passed, but that doesn't mean no one can still be inspired by it. Habendaz may be dead, and I may mostly just want the world to know that, but the circumstances that spawned it persist. The story that thrust it into being keeps being retold generation after generation. People continue to undergo hardships, and that changes the way they make and play things. Rampant loneliness in an interconnected world forms a game about delivering packages to relink society. A mandatory year-long lockdown breathes new life into a fun social game with no real win state besides it's more fun to play than it is not to.
I've said this before and I'll say it again. Games are socio-technical systems. They function based on rules whose design is as influenced by outside factors as much as any other art. Death Stranding wouldn't have made sense 10 years ago. Among Us wasn't fun until the pandemic made it so. So, learn something from Habendaz. Next time things feel rough, and they will, see if you can redirect your hurt. Find in yourself an excuse to make or mutate something, and look for the same process in other work you consume. Remember, nothing was made in a vacuum. Maybe you'll make something with mass appeal, something to help people pass the time and forget about what's worrying them. Or maybe you'll come up with something just to serve a small group of friends stuck together by factors beyond their control. Next game you pick up, throw away the rulebook, throw away the fucking Hedbanz, and see if you can make something more with what's already in your head. Now, if you'll excuse me, I think you've activated my trap card, the Bermuda Triangle.